All right, if you have your Bibles with you this morning, we'd ask you to turn to the book of the Revelation. Revelation chapter 6, and we're going to begin reading in verse 8. Revelation chapter 6, and we're going to begin reading in verse 8. The Bible says, "And I looked, and behold, a pale horse. And his name that sat on him was death. And hell followed him. And power was given unto them over the fourth part of the earth to kill with sword and with hunger and with death and with the beast of the earth. And when he had opened the fifth seal, I saw under the altar the souls of them that were slain for the word of God and for the testimony which they held. And they cried with a loud voice, saying, How long, O Lord, holy and true, doest thou not judge and avenge our blood on them that dwell on the earth? And white robes were given every one of them, and it was said unto them that they should rest for a little season until their fellow servants also and their brethren should be killed as they were should be fulfilled. And I beheld when he opened the sixth seal, and lo, there was a great earthquake, and the sun became black as sackcloth of hair, and the moon became as blood. And all the stars of heaven fell unto the earth, even as a fig tree casteth her untimely figs when she is shaken of a mighty wind. And the heaven departed as a scroll, and it rolled together, and every mountain and island were moved out of their places. And the kings of the earth, and the great men, and the rich men, and the chief captains, and the mighty men, and every bondman and every free man hid themselves in dens and in the rocks of the mountains. And they said to the mountains and rocks, Fall on us and hide us from the face of him that sitteth on the throne and from the wrath of the Lamb. And the great day of his wrath is come, and who shall be able to stand?
Amen.
Dear Lord, we thank you and praise you for this opportunity you've given this morning. Lord, we pray this morning that you would use your words to open hearts. Lord, that you'd sober us at the thought of your coming. Lord, that you would sober us at the thought of our dying. Lord, that you'd make us understand and know that we live in such a temporal place. Lord God, we pray for the lost this morning that you might speak life to them and that you would draw them unto yourself, Lord. We pray for the deceived, Lord, that they might understand and know their situation among you. Lord, we pray for your brethren and for the sisters that are here this morning that you would strengthen them where they walk. It be our prayer this morning in your mighty name. Amen. Now, I'll be preaching this morning in hiding from the Almighty. Now, for the believer and for the redeemed, it seems stupid to hide from the Almighty, but we know redeemed that have. To hide from the person of God, in fact, is something that's inbuilt in each and every one of us. That's why the Bible says in the New Testament, men are lovers of darkness rather than lovers of light, is because we like to hide from God. Because see, when we face God face to face, we have to be real honest with self. Self-honesty, I have found through years and years, is a very sacred commodity. It's few and far between of people that will be really honest with their self. And, you know, this is the biggest one to say, you know what, this is my fault. I take ownership of that. I did that. It is my fault that this happened. You know what? You don't find that today. It's not been in any nation or any age really, but it's less than ever today. And you know what? It's just like this latest school shooting. Whose fault is it? Guns? That's stupid. This book doesn't have any vocation of its own, right? You know whose fault it was? The fault is probably the boy was demon possessed and totally used of Satan himself, and he accomplished the work. Why can't we blame the individual? You know what? He was a foster child. He was adopted out. You know what? We can't blame that. That individual took 18 lives of his own volition, and there's no excuse for that. But you know what? We live in a day when it where it says it's not his fault, right? But you know what? It is his fault. He needs to take ownership of it. And more so than that, we need to take ownership of ourselves and understand what we create, we have done it. But we don't like that. In the eighth verse, the Bible says this, and I, meaning John, and I looked and behold a pale horse. Now, if we have an animal or a child or an individual and they look pale, you know what? Trouble is there. You know, I've never understood to say, you know what, when you go by caskets, and I don't hear it as much as I used to when I was a kid. Old women would go by caskets when I was a kid, they'd say, well, don't they look natural? I'm like, what does that mean? It's a dead body, right? It's somebody in the life is no longer what it looks like to me. He's a dead person, right? And a pale horse means death is coming. That horse is not in good shape. He's not ready to run a race. Death is on its way. And you know what? Whether we accept it or not, death is on the way for each and every one of us under the sound of my voice this morning. Death is coming. And I looked and behold a pale horse, and his name that sat on him was death. Death is coming. Now notice, don't get the two confused, and hell followed him. You know what? If you're not saved this morning, death will come first, and hell will follow him. Death will come first, and then hell will be your home. That's the natural course if Christ doesn't intervene. Death and hell. That's the two ways it will go. You know what? That doesn't need to be sugar-coated in the modern day. It's still death and hell. They go in that order, and the end result is that you'll be there for eternity. So these two are separate individuals, but one follows the other. And hell followed him, and power or authority was given unto them over the fourth of the earth to kill with the sword. Now, I want you to see, very interesting that it was given to a fourth part of the earth. You know, again, just as Brother Junior was teaching in the Sunday school, all that's outlined by God. You know what? If he wanted to give it to the whole earth, he could have knocked them all out, right? But he gave him to a specific area. You know what? One day your specific area is coming up. Your specific day will arrive, and you'll fly out into eternity with Christ or without him. Right? And so we see then that this individual is coming, and his area is limited. And to kill with unto them over the fourth part of the earth, to kill them with sword. Now, I want you to see death will come by natural means. You know what? If you get stabbed with a sword, big good likelihood is you're going to die. Very likely, right? You know what? If you get killed with a sword, you're killed by a sword, but it came through the authority of the Almighty. Does that make sense? He used a means to take you out. And one day he'll use a means, if it's a heart attack, or if it's getting hit by a car, or whatever he takes you out of here with, he works by means, even if it's to the point, you know, Korah and his band, the earth just opened her mouth, but you know what? He still used the means of the earth, and they landed flat in the middle of hell. He uses means, and one day you'll be taken out of here too. You know what? We need to mull over our time of death. That's why we need to make our calling and election sure. So he's going to use the sword and with hunger. Now, if we'd be real honest, there have been very few times, if any, of us have truly been hungry. Now, we've been maybe wanting to eat, but that's a big difference. You know what? You remember back in the 80s, Ethiopia, those of you that are older, I mean, just living skeletons, it was horrific.
Yeah.
That's hunger. And you know what? Many of them died. You know, when the rescue arrived and all the nations began to do a lot of humanitarian acts, I remember this. They were unloading flour from a truck, and one of his huge 50-pound sacks of flour, one of them split open, and people grabbing handfuls and just stuffing dry flour in their mouth. Yeah. That's hunger.
Yeah.
And many of them died. See, he uses whatever he wishes. You know what? I really believe, I don't know this, but I think if I had my choices, I'd rather go by the sword. And you... I'd rather go to the sword than to starve to death. So he says you kill with the sword and with hunger and with death. Now, that seems kind of redundant, but you know what? I've been in healthcare a long time, and I've seen a lot of people. I'll be talking with them, and in the next phrase, they're out in eternity. That's killing by death. You know, just walking along, talking to your wife, and boom, you're out of here. A lot of people will call it a heart attack or some kind of event like that. You know what? That's death. Death comes suddenly sometimes, doesn't it? Death comes and snatches away before you realize it.
Right.
So he was using all these means available into him to judge the earth. Now, with that said, these are lost folks. And I say this because the Lord's people are done pulled out. And so these are lost individuals, helpless with no hope whatsoever. And with death, and with the beast of the earth, in other words, bears and lions and dogs, he was using animals to kill people with too. And when he had opened the fifth seal, verse 9, I saw under the altar the souls of them that were slain for the word of God. Now, where is the altar? It's in glory. It's in heaven. It said all that stuff that we had down here during the Judeo years, all that was just typing a figure of what's up there, right? The Bible says that. And so under the altar there in glory, he saw the souls of men that had given their lives. Now that's the redeemed. That is people that died in serving the Lord. And even to the giving their life. You know, it's one thing if the Lord should tarry his coming and I should die the natural means of death and y'all lay me out here. You know what? I died in the faith, but I didn't die for the faith. You see what I'm saying? It's quite another thing to actually die for the faith and say, you know what? You know what? Peter went down that way according to history, and we know that Stephen went down that according to the inspired word of God. You know what? Stephen would be up under there, one of them saying, how long, Lord, how long? Because he went that way. Now, with that said, all the redeemed are somewhere. And when he'd opened the fifth seal, I saw under the altar the souls of them that were slain for the word of God and for the testimony which they held. Now, if you underline in your Bible, you get that for the testimony which they held. What's your testimony this morning? The testimony which they held. See, how long have you held on to it? See, Baptist people don't like statements like that. But that's exactly what it says, isn't it? The testimony that they held. You know what? If I'm holding this book this morning, I'm holding her. I just dropped it, right? I let it go. I've seen a lot of people let her go, haven't you?
Yeah.
Unfortunately, I've seen about as many let her go as I've seen them hold it. Right? And so then we, as the Lord, you know what that says to me? We need to hold out faithful. as Armenian and as works for salvation, as that might sound, we need to hold out faithful. You know what? We don't need to get in abject sin to prove how mighty grace is. Grace is mighty enough without us having to prove anything. In fact, the Bible says that good works speaks of faith and not the other way around, right? And so we, as the Lord's people, need to certainly understand and know that there are great blessings in holding. Verse 10, and they cried with a loud voice, saying, how long, O Lord, holy and true? They knew He was just. They knew He was holy. They knew that He always was true. Doest Thou not judge and avenge our blood on them that dwell on the earth? In our times, because of the Times conference that's coming up, we have a Time magazine of Adolf Hitler. You know what? I fully believe that that man's got a lot to answer for. You don't step out against Israel. And he did in an unbelievable, horrific way. And he'll answer for that. I fully believe some were estimate about 5 million Jews taken down at his word. That's a 5 million lives to answer for, isn't it? And so we see that they're saying how long, you know, our lives were important. When will we be addressed? Notice what he says. And robe and white robes were given unto every one of them. Now, I fully believe that we'll be decked in white robes in that day. If you're redeemed, you don't deserve it. You didn't earn it. But you know what? You'll be decked out in white robes, and that shows the purity of Christ, because you'll ride into glory on the merit of Christ and not on yourself. That's why your little magical center prayer means nothing to me, because all that is of yourself. That's a fleshly thing.
Yeah.
Right? And so every one of us will ride in on the white road just like that. And he gives that to them. They're given their white robe and they're told to wait. And white robes were given to every one of them. And it was said unto them that they should rest for a little while, a little season. Now, again, if you write in your Bible, mark that one. It said rest, not sleep. Soul sleep is a Catholic fable. Don't ever think David's not sleeping out there. That's his bones, right?
Right.
He's not asleep. He's somewhere in eternity, right?
Right.
Home to be with the Lord or whatever. But just know this. The last breath here is the first one there. And he says, just rest. Enjoy these 7 years, the great years. The glorious studies. Just hang out and rest. The judgment is coming. The judgment is going to happen just like I promised it that it would. And white robes were given to every one of them. And it was said unto them that they should rest for a little season until their fellow servants also and their brethren should be killed as they were, should be fulfilled. And I beheld when he had opened the sixth seal, and lo, there was a great earthquake, and the sun became black as sackcloth of hair, and the sun and the moon became as blood. Now I want you to notice a couple of things there. First of all, the natural disasters that were going to be taking place. But you know, if you believe the Bible, we have to believe that these happen boom, 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 all at the same time. Because see, if the sun quits shining, you're going to see the moon. And you know, we always understand that the sun is the moon is just a reflection of the light of the sun. But somehow it's going to be shining on its own that day. Don't know quite how that's going to happen, but I believe it will be. And then it talks about the stars being cast to the earth, meteor showers all around the earth, just the fury of God being poured out. You know, that's going to be a horrific time to live and to see God's fury unleashed on such a small place. Verse 13, and the stars of heaven fell into the earth as a fig tree casteth her untimely figs when she is shaken of a mighty wind. And the heaven departed as a scroll when it is rolled together, and every mountain and island were moved out of their places. Just calamity everywhere. And the kings of the earth and the great men and the rich men and the chief captains and the mighty men and every bondman and every free man hid themselves in dens and in rocks of the mountains. Now, I want you to notice a couple of things. We would think, seeing the judgment of God, that these people would repent. But they do not. You know, you can't beg people to repent of their sin and get any value out of it. Now, they may give you a little bit of blah, blah, blah. But you know what? I don't want to ride out into eternity on blah, blah, blah. Do you? I want the real deal. If I leave here with nothing else, I want to know the Christ of the Bible. Right? I don't want to fake. So, I want you to see, we can talk about end time prophecy, and certainly we should. What a refreshing thing to us, how glorious it is. And to think, you know what? I'm not going to be dealing with that. I'm not going to go through that. I'm not going to see the calamity that these people are going to endure. But at the same time, don't use that in a mind to scare people into repentance, because you know what? It hasn't ever worked, and it won't work now.
Right. Amen.
It won't work. Literally, the fury of God being poured out on this little planet we call Earth, and them just running and hiding. Now, with that said, you know what? People still want to run and hide from God today. Especially the true God of the Bible. Now, if it's a little Mickey Mouse God that you got in your pocket and want to pull him out when you need him, man, they'll eat that up just like a whole old slop. But if it's a God that is sovereign and holy and magnificent, they don't want to hear it. They simply don't want to hear it. And so we find that this is not a new thought process. This running and hiding and getting out of the way is not something that they necessarily come up with on their own. And the kings hid themselves in dens and the rocks of the mountains and said to the mountains and rocks, fall on us and hide us from the face of him that sitteth on the throne. Now, I want you to see a very interesting thing that a lot of people miss when reading this. It says the scroll was rolled up. This guy was rolled up like a scroll, right?
Yeah.
So apparently they seemed right into the throne room. And they didn't repent. They didn't ask for forgiveness. Their idea was to hide. And what did they cry out to? An inanimate object, an object without life. Rocks, hills, fall out on me. You know what? They want to be hid from God. Now that's the natural push of man. Don't get down on these people too much, because without the goodness of God, that's all you want too, is to hide from God.
Yep.
Especially the true God of the Bible. We don't want to deal with a God. The Bible says, doeth everything after the counsel of his own will. Now, can you imagine that? You know what? If we'd be honest, we've never done everything after the counsel of our own will. Last 30 years, I had someone to consult. If I just jumped right in there and did what I want, you know what? Donna come home, and I said, well, what are you thinking about? See, the Bible says that's wise counsel, right? You don't do anything on your own. Not really. Because he is the only one that can say that. He does everything after the counsel of his own will, and he accomplishes it at what seemeth good unto himself. And so we find these individuals, even in the last days, still denying the very person who God is. Now, go with me back to Genesis chapter 3, and we'll look at the very first sin. Sin made its entrance and manifest itself in the hearts of the people. Genesis chapter number 3, and we'll begin reading in verse 9. Genesis chapter 3 and verse 9. And the Lord called, and the Lord God called unto Adam and said unto him, Where art thou? Now, it's a magnificent thing that God called up unto Adam. Now, I always also found it interesting that he didn't call unto Eve. And that could open up a lot of other things. You know, aren't you glad this morning that God one day called unto you? Because you know what? He didn't have to. I've often wondered if Eve was really saved because he called unto Adam. You see what I'm saying? He called to him. He didn't call to Eve. Now, I will say to this, lost people, if Eve was lost, and I think maybe she was still accountable. Because he said, What is this that thou hast done? See, even though if she was a lost woman, and I don't know, but I know this, he never called to her. He still held her accountable. And if you're lost this morning, don't wipe it off the slate. You're still held accountable. You are accountable to the mighty God of heaven, always and forever. You know what? I saw this on Facebook, and it made my heart tremble. There was this anti-Christian parade, and yes, they do happen. And there was a man, looked about maybe one of my boys' age, maybe a little bit older, and if he had up this sign he was prancing around with, If Jesus comes again, kill him again. You know what? He'll be accountable to that. That makes sweat break out on me. You know what? The very one he denied, he'll show that sign and say, What do you think about this? Everything accountable to God. Lost people, you're as accountable as I am to the mighty God of heaven. And so we see that he calls him out and he makes him accountable. Verse 10, and he said, I heard thy voice in the garden and I was afraid. Fear enters the scene. You know what? When the devil is present, fear is there. You know what? Not everybody that talks about they had never experienced different things, but you don't hear much preached on. They had never experienced fear before, and now they knew what fear was. They were afraid at the presence of God. Now, you know what? At least they had sense enough to be afraid, or he did. Notice, just thinking about if Eve was lost, he said, I was afraid. He didn't say Eve was afraid. He said, I was afraid. And so we find then that he had a new fear. He experienced a new emotion at the judgment of God. And I heard thy voice in the garden, and I was afraid because I was naked, and I hid myself. Now, let me say this. When he said, I was naked, he done made an attempt at clothing. He sold him some fig leaves. But you know what? Deep down in his heart, he knew he was still naked. He got him a little fig tree outfit. But he said to an almighty God, I'm naked.
Yeah.
Don't ever forget this. Man's idea of clothing and God's idea of clothing has always been two different things. Has to be modest. And it has to be specific to the sex, right? And so we find then that he brings him into judgment and he brings him into accountability in one sentence. And he said, Who told thee that thou wast naked? Is thou eaten of the tree whereof I commanded that thou shouldest not eat? And the man said, The woman that thou gavest to me, she gave me of the tree and I did eat. Now, just like today, very first sin, very first pass the buck. Ain't my fault, it's Eve's fault. Eve said, ain't my fault, it's the snake's fault.
Flesh.
Right? Ain't my fault. You know, it didn't work, did it? And you know what? It still doesn't work today. Accountability will never be removed. I'm accountable of my own actions. And you know, I found this working with the elderly and people who are very sick. It's still the very same to the very end. You know, very few people have I talked to in my life that were real accountable. But something my father did that I will always remember is this. We were talking about him and mom's relationship. And he looked at me and said, Larry, don't blame your mother. It was my fault. You know what? That's taking accountability, isn't it? He wasn't perfect. But I have to say this, for that one thing, he said, hey, it was my fault.
Yeah.
Don't you blame her. His exact words was this, June did nothing wrong. You see, that's pretty good, ain't it? You know, very few people, when you have a marriage breakup, it's always, oh, he did this, she did that, they did this, they did that. And everybody, you never hear anybody saying, hey, you know what? I messed up. It was my fault. And so we find that the way, the method that they tried to deal with sin had not really even changed at all. But what the ultimate answer to sin was someone innocent had to die for the guilty. Something that had nothing to do. You think that lamb or whatever animal that was slain from the sacrifice to create the clothing? You know what? They didn't even know what was going on that day. And they had to die for the penalty of another. You know what? That's salvation in a nutshell. He died for the penalty of another. Not one spot or blemish. Never once did he even sin at all. Even down at the temple, that was a righteous thing he did. It wasn't sinful. He cleaned up the temple. He threw that filth. He threw the hypocrisy out. That wasn't sinful. That was a thing that needed to be done. And so we, as the Lord's people, then, in the very, very same way, we need to begin to take accountability. Say, yeah, that was my fault. Yeah, I did that, and it was wrong. I messed up. I let the Lord down. I wasn't doing as I ought to be doing. We need that today in the day which we lived. Now, I want you to go with me to the book of Matthew. And we're going to talk about an individual that hid in religion. Gospel of Matthew chapter 10, just verse 4. Gospel of Matthew chapter 10, verse 4, the Bible says this, Simon the Canaanite and Judas Iscariot, who also betrayed him. Now, as the Lord is giving a list of those that would be named apostles as well as disciples, his last one was just this, Judas Iscariot, that should also betray him. Now, I want you to see what you don't have is you don't have a story of an effectual call. Remember down at the Sea of Galilee, when he says to Simon, Peter, and to James, come follow me.
All right.
He goes a little bit farther and he finds Andrew and says, come follow me. You never ever see that with Judas. Mm-hmm. And you know why? Judas was just along for the ride. And I fear for today, that's a lot of people's idea about the church. They're just along for the ride.
Yeah. Yeah.
And he proved himself. So the first thing, if I was facing eternity tonight, I'd want to be sure that I knew the Lord Jesus Christ, because you know what? I don't think Judas ever did. Even at the very end, the Bible just simply says this: he repented himself. That's not much of a repentance. You know that? You repenting to God, that's a repentance. You repenting to yourself, that's sorry you got caught. And there's a huge difference between the two. And so we find then that all it says, it never tells of his conversion, it never tells of anything except that he was named among the apostles. Gospel of Mark, chapter 3. Mark chapter 3. And we'll read verse 19. Mark 3, verse 19. The Bible says, "And Judas Iscariot, which also betrayed him, and they went into a house." Now again, that's all it says in Mark's gospel concerning him. And I read that to say this, again, no story of conversion at all. And what did they do? It says they went into a house. In other words, he was alone for the ride. You know what? I've slept outside a few times. It's not real pleasant. He was alone for the ride. You know, the Bible says this, that he held back. It means he was their treasure. He kept up with the money.
Right.
You know, that was really his only concern, was what I can get out of this. You know what? We live in a day and age like that today. What can I get out of this? What can life give me? How much money can I make? How big can my house be? How nice can my car be? What can I get out of this? When really, all we really should be saying is, what can I give to the Lord?
Right.
How much time today can I denote for Him? Who can I speak the name of Jesus to? See, Judas was not that type. Judas was self-centered, self-motivated, and always worried and concerned about self. And a selfish person is usually a very good indicator that they've never really known the Lord to start with. Gospel of Luke, chapter 22, verse 3. Luke 22 and verse 3, probably the most scary, or one of the most scary verses in Scripture. "Then entered Satan into Judas, named Iscariot, being of the number of the 12. Now, I've known people that were demon or devil possessed, but I really don't think I've ever met anybody that was possessed by Satan. But Judas was. You know what? That's a very... Well, first of all, you know what has to be missing to be possessed, period? The seal. The Bible says, "Ye are sealed unto the day of redemption." If you're not saved, you're wide open. And with the door open, any devil can get into there. What does the Bible say about Mary Magdalene? We all know, of whom the Lord cast out 7 devils, right?
Right. Yeah.
What else does it say about Mary? Nothing. Did it say that Mary had killed somebody? Did it say that Mary was a harlot? No, the harlot Mary was Mary, the sister of Martha and the sister of Lazarus, right? That was the one that was a hooker. So she was devil possessed, and nothing was really that much noted about her. In other words, she wasn't now axe murdering people like Charles Manson, but she was demon possessed. You see what I'm saying? Now, what about Legion? Of whom 12 legions were cast out. That's 12,000 demons. 12,000 devils. He's flopping. You know, you think about how he's flopping on the floor and biting and throwing himself into the fire. You know what all that is? Just the whole thing is self-destruction. That's what demons do. They bring you to self-destruction. Mm-hmm. Well, I won't say any names, but have a friend that I grew up with, and using the word friend is using it loosely. He was really, no doubt, sent by Satan to bring me down with him. But most self-destruct could have had anything he wanted. He wasn't that smart, but his mom and dad were rich. They were going to pay for a full ride, anything he needed, to Austin Peay State University. He went one semester. In fact, that was on a GED. He never even graduated high school. 14-year-old bought him a very, very nice 1969 Corvette Stingray, hardtop convertible. You know what? Last I knew about him, he was living in a trailer that didn't have a floor in it. That's self-destruction, you see what I'm saying? And that's where, that you know what? You don't have to be flopping on the ground for self-destruction. You don't have to be wallowing at the mouth for self-destruction. That's where demons take you. That's where you're at. But you know what? I'll give you great encouragement in this, even in Legion. All that Jesus had to say is, get thee hence. And it was gone. Even the king of all demons, all that the Lord had to do is to get these hints saved. Thou art defense unto me. And he was out of there. See, that's the beauty of what the Lord can do. Now, one more place and we're going to close. John chapter 18. John 18, verse 5. The Bible says, and they answered him, Jesus of Nazareth. And Jesus said unto him, I am he. And Judas also, which betrayed him, stood with them. Now, if you mark in your Bible, underline that, stood with them. Because listen, this morning, you're standing somewhere.
All right.
You're either standing with him or you're standing against him. There's no in between. There's no partiality. The Bible says, the Gospel of Mark chapter 7, and Judas Iscariot, who was a devil from the beginning.
All right, all right.
But who is he standing with sometime? Christ. You know what? But he showed himself at the end. He was standing with the enemy. What about you this morning? Do you know you're saved? I would hate to approach eternity and be wondering, wouldn't you? In hospice, I've heard different folks says, well, I just hope she'll stand out faithful to the end. Mm. You know, that's a miserable way to die. Mm. Would be for me. I've seen some people, I feel fully convinced they knew the Lord, and when they get demented, blaspheme his name. You know what? I just don't think. I think grace is sufficient. I really do. So do you know him or not? I mean, do you have an experience with Christ where he came to you? Remember that very same passage I just read to you? When he said, I am he, it knocked him on the backs. That's the kind of experience I have with Christ, don't you? I want to know that I know that I know.
Yeah.
No question whatsoever.
Yeah.
When I approach death, if it's very expediently, or if I have to lay around and suffer a few years, I want to know that I know. And you know what? It'll make it all right. It'll make it all right. Do you know him?